So we've all seen it. Watch brands positioning their watches in movies, and sometimes it can work really well, and other times it can completely flop. But if we're looking at consistency, time after time, of a particular character in a movie that just always makes the watches seem to look cooler than they actually are, James Bond has to be at the top of that list. And in this video, we're gonna be looking at the different watches that were worn by James Bond over the years. All right, guys, so as I'm going through this, I wanna keep it relatively in chronological order so it's easier to follow. And I think James Bond in general, you get a sense of where the watch industry is at based on the watch that is actually being worn by James Bond in that moment, maybe when this film is coming out. So it's really cool to kind of see this timeline. And also, before we kind of jump into this, if there's any other just deep analysis you want to see me go through with maybe different characters, I've done a whole series about watches seen in movies, so if you haven't seen those, I can link to those down below as well. But to start us off, let's look at the first watch that was ever worn by James Bond in a film. So this first watch, again, the first watch ever worn on the wrist of James Bond in any movie, and in fact, it was the piece that was on the wrist of Sean Connery when first reciting his most famous line.
Bond. James Bond.
The watch, a Gruen Precision, reference 510. So this showcased a classic gold-filled 34mm case, very just standard for the time, and a white dial featuring Arabic hour numerals at the 12, 3, and 9 o'clock position with a large sub-second dial at the 6 o'clock position. The brand Gruen is actually a brand that made its home in my home state of Ohio, their facility being on the southwest side of the state in Cincinnati, and saw great growth throughout the early 1900s until the company fell into difficult financial circumstances, which forced them to move away from producing wristwatches altogether. And if you want to learn a little bit more about this brand specifically, I've done actually a complete kind of overview of the brand. It was actually a series about watch brands that lost their way. I can link to it in the description. It's actually kind of a fun video to look at. But despite this brand losing its way, they did play a part, and although small, in one of the most iconic cinematic moments ever in movie history. It was featured one last time in the franchise in 1967 in You Only Live Twice. However, despite the featuring of that precision in Dr. No, it was actually not the only watch to be featured in that movie. And when most of us think of the watch featured in that movie, and maybe perhaps the watch most associated with James Bond, we think of the Rolex Submariner. And in this instance, we're looking at the reference 6538. The watch, unlike the Precision, was not only front and center in Dr. No, but also made three more appearances in Bond films played by Sean Connery, which consisted of From Russia with Love in 1963, Goldfinger in 1964, and briefly again in Thunderball in 1965. The watch's inclusion was enough to draw attention to the timepiece, which no question helped elevate the Submariner as the most recognizable watch in the world today. In its feature, we also saw the unique pairing of a NATO strap on the watch that, with its unique striped design, has allowed the strap to be referenced as the Bond NATO. In the reference 6538 is a Submariner reference that is a member of the Big Crown family, it lacking the presence of crown guards, and precedes the introduction of the date that we saw introduced with the reference 1680. The 6538 sports a caliber 1030, and while later models obtained the chronometer certification resulting in four lines at the 6 o'clock on the dial, the one originally worn by Connery in the films featured two line writing at the 6. And I was actually lucky enough to get some hands-on experience with the 6538. I did a sit down with the CEO of Bob's Watches, a partner of the channel, Paul O'Teary, and I will link to that interview down below. We also look at some other rare Submariner references, actually the 6200 and the 6204. But like in nearly every James Bond movie, in 1965's Thunderball, Bond also could be seen with another watch on the wrist. One of my favorites, a Breitling Top Time. The Breitling Top Time was first introduced back in 1964, as Breitling hoped to target a younger demographic and offer just a watch that was more affordable than that of maybe the Navitimer and the Chronomat. And honestly, what better way to do it than to feature it on Sean Connery's wrist as James Bond. The watches featured a myriad of different dial colors and case styles at the time that are both sleek, like their rounded case options from references like the 2002, 03, and 04, and more playful options with cushion cases and their colorful seconds hand, as well as the fun time racing reference 2211. However, the reference that made its way on Bond's wrist was the 2002, a two-register chronograph featuring a reverse panda-style dial. And what makes these watches really cool for me, I mean, I love just the really clean look of these classic chronographs and the fact that they're still reasonably priced, and by reasonably priced, I mean for vintage chronographs from a leading watch brand in Breitling that were also seen on James Bond's wrist. That's a lot of great factors for these things to be totally inflated, but you can still find them for a few thousand dollars on the secondary market, if not less. But for good examples, you're gonna be looking at that, but really interesting watches. Now for our next watch is another chronograph, and with Sean Connery moving away from the role as James Bond, we didn't have to see the departure of Rolex as well, with them making another appearance with the Rolex chronograph reference 6238, a pre-Daytona chronograph in On Her Majesty's Secret Service. So this particular reference, no question, helped pave the way for the 6239 and what we have really come to expect now from even contemporary Daytonas. Its most notable feature differentiating itself is the placement of the tachymeter scale on the dial and featuring a smooth, thinner outer bezel rather than being fixated on the bezel itself that you'll see with actual Daytona models. The watches are of course rare for their use in the film, but this is only added upon considering the watches had a very restrained production, supposedly of just a couple thousand pieces. Now, as I mentioned at the beginning of the video, I think a great way to just get a sense of where the watch industry is at is actually looking at the watches that were on James Bond's wrist. And I think this is a very telling period of the next few watches that we're gonna be looking at of where the status of the watch industry was at. In the first watch here, we have to move into the 1970s. And with the peak of the Kors crisis in full effect here, we saw the feature of a new brand in a watch on the wrist of 007 with Hamilton Pulsar Astronaut reference P22900, worn by Roger Moore in Live and Let Die in 1973. The watch having a traditional digital display and cushioned case style on a steel bracelet was one of the first mass-produced digital watches, with a style that embodied the era and shifting market, as upon the film's release, the P2 and the Submariner were actually retailing for nearly the same price. And the watch can't help but look straight out of Stanley Kubrick's 2001 A Space Odyssey. And just to get a sense of where Hamilton was at as a company, they just moved their head of their operation from Lancaster, PA, where they were at for nearly a century, to Switzerland. And with this, Hamilton really rode out the strength of the Pulsar sub-brand until it was sold off to Seiko in 1978. Which brings us to our next watch and brand on the list, and Seiko. And I don't think many of us considered Seiko and James Bond in the same sentence. I was actually not really aware that Seiko actually was featured in a few James Bond films. And the first one that we saw appear was the Seiko LC reference 0674. This watch made an appearance in The Spy Who Loved Me in 1977, with Bond being played again by Roger Moore. The watch accompanied James Bond throughout the entirety of the film, with the most prominent appearance being in the opening scene, when the agent receives a ticker tape message from M16 ordering him to return to HQ, in which he skis into action. And man, you gotta love those old green screens. This watch is a step up from the Hamilton P22900, which was only able to tell the time. The Seiko LC, on the other hand, had an AM-PM indicator and showcased the proper day of the week at the top of the display. And when looking at this watch, you can't help but think of the Casio F91W. I know I do when looking at this watch closer. But following the appearance of the Seiko LC, Seiko followed up with another watch in the franchise with the Seiko Memory Bank Calendar, reference M354, being worn again by Roger Moore in Moonraker in 1979. And as we go through these digital watches found on the wrist of Bond, we see a gradually elevated complexity as the Seiko Memory Bank Calendar featured a calendar function with functionality for 88 years with a flash reminder function on designated days. And now in the days of smartphones, when you look at features like this, you might think, so what? But back in the late 1970s, these were pretty interesting gadgets and they're suitable for 007 himself. However, James Bond's personal one had a bit of a unique complication, if you want to call it that, as he used the explosive charge hidden in the watch case to blast open a door to escape being burnt alive by rocket engines in the film. And then Seiko made a final appearance with the Seiko H357, worn again, Roger Moore, in For Your Eyes Only in 1981, his second last film as Bond. And after 7 years of digital watches, Agent 007 finally seen sporting a timepiece with an analog display again. However, there is a catch here, as the H357 features two displays, one digital and one analog. To add to the complexity as well, the watch also featured a calendar alarm and a stopwatch function for added functionality. And as Seiko was a surprise as a feature in the Bond franchise, this next watch from Tag Heuer is another surprise that you may not suspect being on the wrist of James Bond, with the Tag Heuer Professional 200 meters reference 980031, being worn by Timothy Dalton in The Living Daylights in 1987. This watch had no real significance to the movie itself. However, it was included in the list as it was a debut appearance for the brand in the franchise. The model itself is a mid-size PVD-coated watch with a fully loomed dial. The watch and its positioning was a result of a merger that took place 2 years prior in 1985, or actually an acquisition, when Technique Avant-Garde, a Luxembourg-based company, and British business ambassador Ron Dennis acquired the rights to the brand Heuer. This feature was perhaps the first mainstream introduction to the new brand's identity and helped certainly with just the popularity of Tag and their quickly expanding authorized dealer reach throughout the 1990s. However, for the last 25 years, we'll just say this is more of contemporary Bond, there's really just one brand, a Swiss brand, that has been closely associated with James Bond, and that is Omega. And for the first Omega that we have on the list for James Bond and where it made an appearance was the Omega Seamaster Professional 300, reference 2531-8000, worn by Pierce Brosnan in Tomorrow Never Dies in 1997. Again, in The World Is Not Enough in 1999, and Die Another Day in 2002. The watch that made the appearance in these movies was the automatic version, but we also saw a similar case variant of the watch that appeared in GoldenEye 1995, which featured a quartz movement. The watch did have multiple gadget functions. Firstly, Agent 007 used the helium escape valve connected to the microchip to shatter a glass jar holding a grenade in Tomorrow Never Dies in 1997. And James Bond's probably the only guy that can actually use that helium escape valve nowadays. I think they're honestly pretty useless to have on the watches, but hey, that's just me. And then again, in The World Is Not Enough in 1999, the exact same watch is used to light up the inside of an inflatable avalanche safety ball, and also use the watch as a grappling hook to escape from a nuclear silo with Dr. Christmas Jones. The watch itself comes with a 41mm case, sports 300 meters of water resistance, and has that helium escape valve at the 10 o'clock position. The watch's specific sales numbers never have really been disclosed, but I don't think it's any secret that this is probably Omega's best-selling watch of the last few decades. And you can still see just the fingerprints of this watch in the entire Seamaster catalog still today. As these Omegas were just simply ubiquitous and were basically the watches that epitomized the classification of a Bond watch for some time, until 2005 with the release of a new line from Omega known as the Planet Ocean line. First introduced as a way to time up with the release of Daniel Craig's first Bond film, Casino Royale, in 2006.
Former SAS types with easy smiles and expensive watches. Rolex?
Omega.
Beautiful.
But the specific watch that we're going to be looking at to really epitomize this era is the watch that was worn in the movie Spectre by Daniel Craig in 2015. The Omega Seamaster 300 reference 233-3231-4121-0101. Known as the Omega Seamaster 300 Spectre. So this watch was produced as a limited edition piece, but I put that in sarcastic air quotes as it was produced to 7,007 pieces, which certainly is a large production run to be labeled as such. However, the watches have maintained prices well in the secondary market as a result of being, of course, featured in the films themselves, but also being vintage-inspired design watches featuring faux patina, had that cool lollipop second hand with a 007 branded buckle and a black ceramic bi-directional bezel ring, built with a 12-hour scale on the actual bezel itself. And then in addition, for the internals, they're no joke as well, featuring a coaxial caliber 8400, featuring a free sprung balance with silicon balance spring, helping to lend to the resistance to magnetic fields of greater than 15,000 Gauss. So in short, a watch that is not simply a cash grab, as the specs within are certainly 007 worthy. All right guys, so if you like this video, be sure to give it a thumbs up. What is your favorite watch that was worn by James Bond? And another question in the comments for you guys, do you think James Bond is still as cool? Do you think seeing a watch on the wrist of James Bond still has as much pull nowadays as it did maybe back in the 1960s? I think for my generation, I just feel like there's such a different connection to the character than there was maybe in generations past. But love to see comments down below. And guys, if you want to see more of this, of course, give this video a thumbs up, subscribe, and hit that bell icon. If you want to get an amazing watch strap for your watch, head over to teddybalancer.com. If you want to maybe get one of these iconic pieces, chances are one of them might be available at Bob's Watches, a partner of our channel. If you use the link in the description to buy a watch that supports us and the content that you're watching. And then finally, if you want to join our watch giveaway, fill out that watch giveaway form and then follow me on Instagram. I've been posting a lot of cool content there as well. So, kill two birds, go ahead and follow me. So guys, thank you again so much for watching. Be well, and I will see you all very soon.